possibly no country better exemplifies a digital opportunity than China. And with the world's fastest growing big economy and explosive middle class, the world's largest online population, China is squarely in the viewfinder for every ambitious media company in the world. And to talk about China's media opportunities and its challenges, we're honored to have with us today Li Ruigang, chairman of China Media Capital, one of the most influential figures in the China media scene today. And he'll be talking to Wendy Mitchell of Screen International and ScreenDaily.com. Please join me in welcoming them.
Thank you everybody for being here. I think we're going to have a very exciting chat. Yeah. Not just about pandas, which I think was the tagline. We're with Li Ruigang, yes, who is the chairman of China Media Capital, which he helped found in 2010. Just a bit about his background. He's got a master's from Shanghai's Fudan University. He was a visiting scholar at Columbia in New York, which explains his perfect English. He started his career as in television and documentary producing, and from 2002 to 2011, he was president of Shanghai Media Group, which I think revolutionized the Chinese landscape. So I want to start by asking you a little bit more about China Media Capital, because it's a fairly new outfit, and I think a lot of people here would benefit from knowing a little bit about what you're doing, how you're set up.
Yeah, thank you. I left Shanghai Media Group last year. Shanghai Media Group is, so far, by revenue, is second largest media company in China. I left that company last year and set up the China Media Capital, CMC. And the China Media Capital is the first media investment platform in China. We are backed by Chinese government, central government. But we are doing our business in a marketized way. So right now our largest LP is the China Development Bank. Yeah. So far, in the past 2 years, we made a few deals. The first investment is we acquired the majority shares of the Star TV, you know, Chinese speaking Star TV and Channel V in mainland China. The project, this company, this joint venture right now is doing very well, and it will go public in the next few years. The second deal and the third deal, and also there are also the joint venture between TVB, Hong Kong-based a broadcaster, and also the DreamWorks. Recently, half a year ago, we signed a partnership with DreamWorks, a US-based animated movie production company. And this is also the joint venture between a China consortium led by CMC and DreamWorks. And also we recently did another investment in the home shopping, TV shopping. We invested the largest home shopping channel in China. And we are also looking at some other opportunities, including live entertainment, sports, content creation, et cetera. Yeah. So this is basic background of CMC.
Can you tell me how much money is available?
Yeah, the size of our current fund is $300 million US dollar. So it's not big, but still, I mean, in China's media market, we are very practical to look at the different opportunities.
I want to talk a little bit more about that DreamWorks deal, and okay, maybe what it signals to the rest of Hollywood, what they could be doing, how you're trying to be different than how Hollywood has worked in China in the past. You're going to be working on films for both, specifically for the Chinese market, but that will travel very well internationally, starting with Kung Fu Panda 3. So maybe you can talk a little bit about how this deal is different than what we've seen before.
Okay. The joint venture between China Party and DreamWorks is the first of this kind of joint venture in China, because it's in the past, a lot of Hollywood studios tried very hard to break up the lines to set up joint venture of local the production house on the ground, but they failed. So this is the first time for a Hollywood production studio working in China. The joint venture between 12 hours started half a year ago, and we signed a partnership with them. And so far, I think there are two aspects we are working on. One is the production, animated movie production. And so we will build a studio in Shanghai. We are bringing the pipeline from Los Angeles to Shanghai. And we are targeting at the first movie, which is the co-production of Kung Fu Panda 3 in 2016. And later, in 2017, we will have original movie coming from Shanghai. And I think we are targeting at maybe 5 or 6 years, or even later, we will try to build, try to produce 2 to 3 movies per year from Shanghai City. And around the production business, we're also going to tap into the related business, including distribution, merchandising, gaming, even live entertainments. So this is one part of the whole joint venture. The other part is the so-called it's not theme park. It's kind of tourist attraction in downtown Shanghai. Because Disney is going to build a theme park, Disneyland, in Shanghai. It will open, I think, 2016 or 2017. So we are going to, our joint venture is going to, in the downtown, we just acquired a piece of land in downtown Shanghai to build a tourist entertainment, media entertainment, attraction. It's a entertainment complex with theaters, with cinemas, with boutique hotels, cafe, restaurants. So there will be a lot of attractions for the tourists. Yeah. So there are two parts put together in this joint venture. Yeah.
I wanted to also ask you a little bit about exhibition and distribution of films in China, because it's been booming so much. Because of 60% in 2010, up at least a little over 30% last year. Can this growth be sustained? Is it going to hit a plateau at some point? Also, the quota system is going to change with what films can be released. So where do you see the film market going in China?
Compared with the past, film market, film business become more and more attractive. And a lot of investment, so-called hot money, just rushing into this market, both into the, into both the movie theater and also the movie production. And so you can see, so far, currently there are more than 10,000 screens in China. So the increase rate is very, very fast. And also the box office is also increased very fast by every year more than 30% increase. Yeah. So this is
Do you think that's going to continue at that rate?
Yeah, I think so. Yes. Okay. I think so. Because you can see there are a few points. First one is the demand from the market. People, people are willing to spend that time in the theater, compared with the past. But the high quality contents is the key. Second thing is the government is eager to promote the movie industry, especially in the past few years. Government issue a lot of the policy, favorable policy, try to promote this industry. Although there are still piracy happening, the market evolves very fast.
I did want to touch on piracy and is piracy, how rampant is it, and what are legitimate businesses doing to what are the companies you invest in doing to prevented?
Because my experience, you know, most of my experience in the past is operation. So also right now we got up, you know, some portfolio companies under CMC. So my thinking is the piracy hurts not only the foreign content, but also the local productions. So I'm positive to look at right now the situation is the government and the local industry working together, try to crack down the piracy issue. So I think there will be there is and there will be a lot of developments in this area.
Another area I wanted to look at was obviously the theme this year in Abu Dhabi is digital. So looking at new media, and you said that a lot of people working with China Media Capital have new media backgrounds, and maybe you can talk a little bit about what kinds of investments, where you see growth in new media in China in coming years.
I think, you know, because of a new media area, it's relatively less regulated. So in the past few years, there's a lot of foreign investment and also domestic investment, you know, putting into this area. And some of the big new media companies' websites were listed in US, in Hong Kong market. So this market is still booming market, but there are also some risk. What I can see in the next few years is the consolidation in this market. In China, the typical phenomenon in the media entertainment market, also in the new media market, is the fragmentation. In the traditional media entertainment market, because of the political reason, because of the historical reason, there are lots of the fragmented, you know, TV stations, radio stations, print medias, you know, sitting on different layers, like a pyramid, you know. On the top, there are central media, CCTV, China Daily, you know, People Daily, China Radio, and on the provincial level, on the city level, county level, there are a lot of media organizations. They're all separate. No, they don't have any connection in terms of assets, you know, in terms of acquisition or merger situation, you know. So in the future, I think this trend or this phenomenon will be changed. And also in the new media world, in China, there is also kind of phenomenon, you know, when successful application, you know, is created, there will be a lot of followers. So you can see a lot of, you know, similar applications, platforms around. On one hand, it creates a lot of duplication. Sometimes waste a lot of resources. But on the other hand, I think from the perspective of a media fund, it offers us a lot of opportunities to do the consolidation in the near future.
So you're thinking less local media or some consolidation there, so that it becomes at least regional or national?
Yes.
In some cases.
Yeah, in some cases. I think the roadmap of China's media, you know, becoming a more, you know, kind of, you know, consolidation is not like what you have done in the U.S., in the West. Because according to the current regulation, current policy, you cannot do, you know, for example, like broadcasting media, TV and radio, you cannot do merger acquisition in China so far. But technology will change. Will change the landscape of media because of the internet, because of mobile application, because of the terminal. So eventually, the terminal, the interface, will aggregate contents, will change the behavior of people, watching behavior of people. So people will stick to a interface, a branded interface, instead of, you know, like the merger acquisition, instead of setting up the big networks around the country. So that's the technology, the power of the technology, I think.
And you've mentioned consumer behavior. Wondering if you could tell us a little snapshot now of what young people in China, what, you know, what internet platforms they're using, how they're using media, how they're consuming. Are they looking for on-demand content? Are they user-created content?
I think behavior now. I think it's quite similar. You know, Chinese young kid, young media consumer, the kids, you know, their behavior is similar to the rest of the world. I think, you know, from my observation, you know, they are not raised by their parents. They are raised by internet. You know, maybe I can give you two examples. Talking about the watching behavior, you know, the young media consumers, they spend more and more time on the computer, laptops, iPads, to watch TV instead of watching the screens. And even when they watch the TV screens, they use the computers, pads, to be interactive with their friends. So this is different watching behavior compared with the past. And it will give a lot of the opportunities for the media operator to think about how to change their business model by integrating these new media applications. The second example is probably the e-commerce. You know, my observation is the young media consumers, they spend huge time on e-commerce. So probably it's that the offline merchandising will get killed, you know, eventually or significantly in this way.
And not just in media, in fashion and other areas of business?
Yes. Talking about the VOD, yeah, you know, the video on demand business, it's everywhere. You know, you can get contents on, you know, on internet, mobile, it's very easily. The best thing is people enjoy free contents.
Yeah.
Instead of, you know, paying for content.
Are there successful models where people are paying for content?
Yeah, they try very hard. The websites try very hard to change the behavior, but it's still hard. And the thing is, because of the fragmentation, people can easily find the free contents. So eventually, you know, the consolidation will help. They change, you know, will help the website change the business model into a more pay-oriented model.
And what about mobile usage? How are people using their mobile phones? Are they using that for streaming content?
Yes.
Interacting or tweeting?
Yes. In China, this very popular, yeah, everywhere.
Yeah.
China version of Facebook, China version of Twitter, you know, those applications everywhere. People love it.
And looking ahead to what China Media Capital is going to be doing, where do you see your future investments? What's going to be what you're looking to invest in next?
Basically, there are two aspects. One is we are looking closely at the government reform regarding how to evolve the media industry. Because China government is willing to do reform in the media industry. In a big picture, China wants to evolve its whole economy into a more service industrial oriented phase. So media will play a big significant role in the service industry. Secondly, I think this demands content demands, high quality content demands from the market. So, because we have very close relation with the government, so we look at the government, you know, their pace of reform, and we will be ahead of others to take advantage of this reform and to do the investment. Second, we are also looking at some other new, you know, opportunities, for example, live entertainment, sports. I think this market in China will be the next, you know, opportunities will be those. Other than the traditional media or the so-called new media, the sports, live entertainment, big market opportunities.
In terms of music?
Music, like music, yeah, festival, concert, tour, sports leagues, sports marketing, those kind of things.
And is your company involved in that currently?
Yeah, very much.
What are you doing now with sport?
Sports, we are still looking at some opportunities. The thing is, right now, you know, China's sports, in terms of its performance, you know, professional performance is quite impressive, you know, talking about Olympics or other international competition. But in terms of the, you know, the market, sports market, it's still in at a very early stage. The basic situation is, in China, the sports leagues, they are part of the government. All the sports associations, they are just part of the government. So have not been privatized or marketized fully. So it takes time to, you know, to lobby with government, to educate with government, to persuade government to let them go to market. On the other hand, is the media. Because the sports media, especially the TV, sports TV, is still controlled by the state-owned, you know, investment or the government. For example, like CCTV, right now the largest sports channel is CCTV5. It's still the state-owned on the central TV station. So it's harder for a sports league to negotiate with CCTV to have a, you know, fair price for its distribution rights. So I think the situation will be changed eventually, but it's on the road.
And what would you say to foreign partners and investors, and even Middle Eastern partners and investors? How can they get involved in China? Where are the areas that foreign investment is most welcome?
That's a good question. I've been asking this question many times. Yeah. I think, in general, China welcomes investment, foreign investment. But the media is still sensitive, you know, obviously. So when I talk to like DreamWorks, because they wanted to do something in China, and I talked to them what they can do, what they cannot do. The thing is, there are a few things. For example, like you have to do something, try to meet the local demands while fitting to the local regulatory framework. And also you have to think about how can you bring in best practice of your company, of your model into China, which is beneficial to the country, to the whole local industry. And probably the most important things, do you have the better understanding of the local culture, local laws, regulations, policies? And do you have the ability of successfully localize your model on the ground? That's the key issue for you to consider.
That's a lot. How can people learn more about somebody told me recently, you've really got to be on the ground there. It's not business that can be done on the phone or on email. You have to come to China. Yeah. Would you agree with that, that people have to come visit and get to know the local market?
Sure, definitely. Yeah, more visits, more exchanges. Well, that will help a lot.
And your company, you're open, obviously, to international partners.
Yes, yeah, we are open to, you know, different kinds of investments. Yeah. And, you know,
And I mean, how fast do you think China is going to change? Maybe the media. How fast is Chinese media changing? Already, it seems to be a lot of change.
You know, there have been a lot of changes, you know, compared to, you know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, when I just graduated from from the university. You know, there have been a lot of change, dramatic change. But I don't think the change will, in China, in the media circle, the change will happen dramatically. Some people ask me, you know, because we are going to have another, you know, government leadership change very soon. I don't think there will be a big change in media circle after that, you know, leadership transition. The change or the involvement in the media circle in China will be smooth, gradual, at its own pace. However, I think media industry has its own, China's media industry has its own logic to evolve because of the demands from the market, because of the technology, and because of the outside, you know, outside media, outside industry, outside drivers, like our capitals, like, you know, partners, try to bring the new expertise into the industry and change the landscape of the media. Yeah.
I think that's a big point, but we're out of time, so I think we'll wrap there. But thank you very much to Li Ruigang from China Media Capital.
Thank you.